Welcome, and I would like to introduce you to Eva Rosenstock today as our keynote speaker of our archaeological keynote. So Eva studied pre- and protohistory, physical anthropology, and comparative linguistics in Tübingen in Germany and in Durham in the UK. She received her doctorate in prehistoric archaeology from Tübingen University with a dissertation on Neolithic tell settlements in Southwestern Asia and Southeastern Europe, for which she was awarded the travel grant of the German Archaeological Institute. From 2006 to 2018, Eva was a research associate and lecturer at the Freie University in Berlin. Since 2018, Eva has been a research associate at the interdisciplinary Einstein Center Chronoi Berlin. Her projects include excavations in Central Anatolia, funded by the Alexander-von-Humboldt-Stiftung, an Emmy Noether junior research group called Lives, investigating human stature in prehistory, founded by the German Research Foundation. She did research on aspects of cattle traction in prehistory and the archaeology of dairying, as well as questions of time reckoning and time management during Neolithicization. Today, she will talk about a new axial age, epoch-making changes around 3000 BCE in Southwest Asia and Europe. Eva, we are very happy that you are here, and please take it away and start your keynote.
Thank you so much for these introductory words, and especially for having me in your school. I would love to be in Jena in person in a real school, but this is at least something. And I thought about what shall I talk about given the scope of your summer school, and I thought I'm the archaeologist among the keynote speakers, so I should make it as archaeological as I can given the background that I have that you've just heard about. So today I'm trying to unfold some ideas that we are currently exploring in our Einstein Center Chronoi. And in a way, we'll also weave in some research that I have done before that sort of connects to this general topic. And this is the outline, what we are doing today. First, I would like to give a quick introduction into what the idea of axial ages in history is and where it has come from. And then we will move on forward from Karl Jaspers' original idea to the idea that we are currently developing in Chronoi together with Hermann Partzinger, if there's maybe more such axis or time axis in the deep history of the human past. So in a way, it's a topic that you would also address with global history, global prehistory, and even with deep history. And then we specifically look at the fourth millennium BCE as a particular interesting and lively turning point, or actually period in prehistory, where many things happened. And out of these many things, I just want to pick out two. And these are, don't be surprised, biotechnology and engineering. And in the end, after these two examples, we will wrap up and try to wind back to whether we could call 3000 BCE or the fourth millennium a time axis or a new axial age or an epoch in prehistory, and how this relates to chronological thinking. So after the impression of World War II and all the turmoil, historian Karl Jaspers, and he was also a law person, sat down and wrote an essay-like history book called Vom Ursprung und Ziel der Geschichte, actually what history is about. And there were a few pages in the middle of that book that say that the first millennium BCE is something he Jaspers would call an axial age, because Jaspers noted, he was not the first to note this, that in the first millennium BCE, in a number of regions in the old world, and you see a rough map of these regions here, thinking developed into a way that can be called reflective or moralizing or ethic or something. You know, think about the biblical prophets. I have this bit tacky picture here. Think about the Greek philosophy that emerged in the first millennium. Think about Zoroastrianism in Iran, and think about Buddhism in India and Confucianism in China, in the Far East. So they are all sort of, these are developments that try to reflect on how humans should behave, how they could, what the common shared values are. Egalitarianism and topics as such as these are also coming up in this time. And this meant a significant turning point in Jasper's thinking. And he thought that here humanity is coming along into something where actually it's getting modern or closer to what we are or what we understand. Whereas he viewed prehistory, he was a historian, as something that's interesting, but not, we cannot grasp it. There's no texts, and we cannot find out what people were doing and how they behaved, and especially how they thought in prehistory. And that was in the late 1940s. And I think his prehistoric research has moved on a lot since then. And what seemed to Karl Jaspers a gray, foggy, distant past is now something where we can actually try to understand what was in people's brains and heads as well. Maybe, I hope so. But we will first look at where this idea of an axial age came from and where it went to. It is an idea that was already developed in the 18th century and has some roots even in the 17th century in Renaissance thinking and early modern historical thinking, because many people before Karl Jaspers noted these similarities between early philosophies or religions in the ancient world. But this idea that it is a first millennium BCE phenomenon was soon qualified by several researchers. And you see a synopsis from a recent article here that for some researchers, the axial age goes back into the second millennium BCE. For others, it reaches well into the medieval period. So that's not something that is really a defined time, but rather something vaguely defined, something that actually an axis or a zone or an epoch would be a better word for. And there has been a lot of writing about this idea of an axial age and how Jaspers conceived it in the last years. For example, by important and influential Egyptologist in Germany, Jan Assmann. I'm not sure if there's an English translation of this already out there. And moreover, there is a big cliometrics-oriented project going on currently. It's the SESHAT project, and I think some members or related people are in the audience, at least I heard so in the a few weeks ago. And the SESHAT project wants to collect large databases on human history, a bit maybe like the human area relations files that you know from cultural anthropology of the modern and recent eras, and take that approach further into the past, and use this data with a proper statistical, formal scientific approach. Statistically, it's called cliometrics, such approaches to make inferences for the past. And they have written a history of the axial age where they looked at the first millennium BCE and preceding and subsequent periods on a global scale, just as a highlight, checking if in Hawaii also we see the same developments in the first millennium BCE or whether we don't see them. And they come to the conclusion that, okay, there might be some truth in this, but it's not an entirely global phenomenon, of course. And they have recently also checked whether the emergence of religions with moralizing gods and divine kings, as you know them from the ancient Near East, for instance, is a prerequisite or a consequence of state formation. A paper that has been discussed quite controversially over the last 2 years. And they really try to find operation data one can operationalize for finding out what people's mentality was. It's a challenging idea and a challenging topic, and I'm watching them really closely what they published. There have soon been people who took sort of a free ride on this idea of an axial age and said, maybe there have been more ages like that, turning points in human history. And one of them was Kosellek, Reinhard Kosellek, a German philosopher and historian who went into historical theory a lot. And he said that the time around 1800, he called it the saddle zeit, not because of the riding saddle, but because of the saddle between two mountains, that this saddle period, actually the beginning of industrialization and everything, is another turning point in human history. And it was, for instance, also connected with accelerating processes everywhere. I mean, industrialization sped up the world increasingly with machinery, with work sharing, with factory work, shift work, and all these effectiveness issues during industrialization that actually made every production process and also our lives so much faster, probably, that's the idea behind it, than people, let's say, in the medieval or in the early modern period. And then prehistorians in the last years have also started to identify periods, times in which things change pretty rapidly. And you see us here from the a big excellence cluster funded by the German Research Foundation during the last years. It's now ended in Berlin, the excellence cluster Chronoi. They had a project led by Sven Hansen and by Jürgen Renn, who is the head of the MPI for the science of history in Berlin and for the MPI Max Planck Institute there. And they together identified phases where prehistory changed a lot, where life must have changed considerably for people. For instance, if you look at the green axis in the fourth millennium BCE, you see words like wheels and wagon and plow and so on. This is all reminiscent of a leap in technology that might have increased working speed and general production speed and life speed, very much like Kosellek's Sattelzeit. And that's one of the issues that we are talking about in Chronoi these days, whether people actually felt an acceleration, not only during the subtle side transition, but maybe even already in prehistory in the fourth millennium. And this green time slice, the fourth millennium, is exactly what we are looking at. Although Hermann Partzinger, in a recent publication in this World History here, edited by Irie and Osterhammel, has proposed that not only 3000 BCE and the proper axial age, but a number of additional time periods in prehistory and early history could be qualified as time axis, similar to an axial age. And he has outlined a few of these potential turning points in human prehistory that start from the invention of the spear thrower or bow and arrow that he in his model puts around the late Upper Paleolithic and progresses over Neolithization to the copper metallurgy, certainly a turning point that went very quick in the whole ancient Near East extractive copper metallurgy in Southeastern Europe, including parts of Europe. And then the fourth millennium with, for instance, wheeled vehicles. He sees another turning point, 2000 BCE, which is a bit vague, I think, in how it's defined. And then, of course, at the end of the second millennium, we see iron metallurgy. And another turning point that could be the exact axial age around 300 BCE. So that was a draft. And I think it's well worth going further from this draft and investigating this idea of such turning times a bit more in detail. And this is what we are going to do in the second part for 3000 BCE. Such overarching turning points or stages ideas are currently a bit fashionable, I have the impression. If we look at Paleolithic research, you see here an approach by Miriam Heidle and Nicolas Connard and some other highly prominent Paleolithic researchers who have said that human cultural capacities, as they put it, have expanded according to an expansive model that you can see here with basic tool use, the starting point we take here that we see with great apes already, and then modular tool use, which means that you have a tool and you use that tool to produce another one, like flaking a cleaver or making a lithic tool. And then the next step would be composite tools, like if you glue lithic pieces to a piece of wood using a glue, then you get a composite tool. That's something that we have never observed with animals, for instance. Also, modular tool use has never been observed or rarely, as it's debated. And with complementary tools that consist of two parts, like the bow and the arrow, or the spear and the thrower, that the skilled human has wheeled together in a very right way, like the bow and then the arrow, and you really have to know what you're doing. Your human body is the connecting piece, how these two pieces should move together. That's the next step. And then their final step, because they end with the end of the Paleolithic in their model, is notional capacity, where we are talking about the emergence of art, of symbolic action, of symbolic representation, maybe of religion and things like this. And in a way, I think this is can just be seen as a prequel, and it would be very interesting to put these together, and this is what I'm going to do in my last part of the talk. And if you hear about axial ages, about revolutionary periods, of course, you have to start with Weergarten Child and his idea of a Neolithic revolution, which would be sort of 8000 BCE in the scheme of Hermann Patzinger that we have just seen. And but the Neolithic revolution has been sort of qualified by several researchers over the last decades quite a lot, because actually, what is left from the real Neolithic revolution is now only the gray circle that you see on top, the decrease of foraging and the increase of farming of animals and plants, including domestication. Whereas all other developments, like pottery, the shift from a community-oriented economy to a household-oriented competing economy, for instance, are all traits of later stages within the Neolithic transition, which have, for instance, by Avi Gofer, you see his picture on the right, been termed as the second Neolithic revolution. And that's a concept that matches quite nicely with the idea of Amy Bogart, an archaeobotanist, that only at the end of the PPNB, so the pre-pottery Neolithic, in the eighth millennium, maybe a bit into the seventh, farming, plant farming, and animal farming, so husbandry and plant cultivation, were really integrated. Like before, according to Amy Bogart, they were separate entities with the animals here and the plant plots there. And only by this later stage, maybe by the second Neolithic revolution, the both became intertwined, with, for instance, manure being brought onto the fields and the remains of the plants that you would not eat as a human as fodder for the animals and so on. That's a very fascinating idea that she has brought up here. And this could explain a lot of these changes that we see, that we have the feeling that the Neolithic only becomes a real Neolithic with the pottery Neolithic in the seventh millennium. And that exactly is the time when the Neolithic expands out of its homeland in the Near East, where we talk of something that is primary neolithization. That means that here, the very animals and plants that were used by foragers when they were still wild slowly undergo domestication in the Neolithic transition. And whereas if the Neolithic is brought to another region by means of migration or acculturation, and the plants are taken out of their homelands into a new habitat, this happened somewhere between the border between Central Anatolia and the Aegean, so somewhere here. If you can see my mouse, So here would be the very end of where we can talk of primary neolithization, and then it expands by means of migration and acculturation, and this is called secondary neolithization. And then there's a very late neolithization from 3000 BCE onwards, or in the fourth millennium, interestingly, in the fourth millennium, up in Scandinavia and in the British Islands, which is so late that it already could be called a Copper Age or a Bronze Age almost, and has a certain traits, including the art as a land tilling instrument, that doesn't make it really Neolithic anymore. And this is called, therefore, a tertiary neolithization. So the Neolithic revolution has disintegrated a bit. So these time axes are always a bit vague and broad, but still they are in a way there, I think. And another important time axis, which would be congruent with the one that we see in the fourth millennium, is Biergartenchild's urban revolution. Biergartenchild's urban revolution. Biergartenchild said that in the later prehistory, like maybe fourth millennium, third millennium, early states were developed out of a process of craft specialization that was largely driven by copper metallurgy that emerged in the fifth millennium. And Andrew Sherritt has added to this or modified this by looking at animal produce and called it the secondary products revolution, because he felt that the exploitation of animals gained new momentum in the fourth millennium by the widespread use of animals in traction for wagons and arts, and by the use of the wool of sheep, and by the use of dairy. In these times, dairy was indeed thought to be something that's pretty late in human development. We now know that it is at least as old as the second Neolithic revolution, at least as old as the pottery Neolithic, but still, researchers, archaeozoologists like Haskell Greenfield, like the idea of this secondary products revolution as an intensification phase of trades that before were just so-so there in on a minor scale, and that really were expanded and targeted during the secondary products revolution. And this is what we are going to look at in the realms of biotechnology, and then in the realms of engineering. To start looking, if we want to look into dairy first as a biotechnological process, we will start with my own excavation in Çatalhöyük West. Çatalhöyük is right in the middle of Anatolia. I should have pointed it out on the map before, but I'm sure you all know where Anatolia is. And it's close to the city of Konya in modern Turkey. And there is this large east mound that was dug by James Mellard in the 1960s. and which is the famous site. And then there is a minor site just a few hundred meters to the west, termed the West Mound, and neglected by research. From Mellard over Ian Hodder, they all didn't really care about the West Mound. And this is where we ended up to dig, my co-PI Peter Beal in Buffalo, now University of California, and myself. And we've been there since 2006. And this site was thought to be separated from Çatalhöyük by a hiatus, but it's not. It's actually a continuation of the site of Çatalhöyük, a seamless continuation, and it shares many traits. And the seamless continuity has just been published a few years ago in Antiquity based on the radiocarbon dates. But we are not about whether we are part of the site of Çatalhöyük today or not. We are here to see whether there was dairy in the Çatalhöyük West Mound. And our material comes from one trench where we unearthed architecture that is as agglomerating as you would expect in Neolithic Central Anatolia, with houses that do not have spaces between them. And these houses have large pillars on their inside. Each house has a plus minus four internal buttresses built of mud brick as the entire construction. These buildings were probably two stories high, and in these houses we found deposits that we interpret as middens, especially our field director Jana Anvari interprets them as middens. And these middens contained a lot of pottery, really a lot. You can see that there's in cases more pottery than earth actually. And that pottery sometimes had a weird calcification on the inside that to our pottery specialist Ingmar Franz looked a bit like the stuff you get inside a water kettle on the side. I mean, we have this teapot on the side where everybody is making tea water all day, and it looked exactly the same, and probably the same water in the past as well. So our working hypothesis was that this is just kettle stone. But kettle stone is calcitic, and when I met Jessica Handy, who has been working on the MPI in Jena soon thereafter, and she's based in York now. And she talked about dental calculus as a calcitic deposit that's able to trap food proteins. I was all thrilled, and I told her about these calcitic deposits and whether it would be worthwhile to sample them for proteins as well. And Jessie said, It can lead to nothing, but it might well worse. Nobody has ever tried it. Let's try it. I had money at hand and we tried. And of course, we didn't use this super nice bowl that you see here that has even, if you look here, in the middle of its bottom, a soot mark indicating that it was maybe used over a stove. Of course, we couldn't sample this one. We sampled little shirts with adhering calcitic deposits. And I'm not going to talk to you about the lipid and the proteomic analysis basics, because you have learned them all over the last 2 weeks, I think. But what we did was proteomics, shotgun proteomics, which are able to identify the entire range of proteins that are there. It's not a targeted thing. It's just looking, is there anything and what is it? And we were doing especially targeting caseins, of course, and whey proteins. And lipid analysis was, of course, used to further qualify and corroborate the results. And the results of proteomics was quite fascinating, because we had a lot of proteins in there. Actually, the whole range of plants and animal species that was used in Çatalhöyük West, and we had dairy. The blue symbols are dairy proteins, and it was super exciting to see that not only cattle, which was the main hypothesis for milk in the years in research before, but that also animals like sheep and goat were apparently milked. And in one vessel 22, we found only whey proteins, which means that the cheese fraction was probably already taken away from the dairy that was contained in that vessel before dairy was put in. So at the moment, but lipids that we also found are a bit of a problem in interpretation. We are thinking about the idea that this vessel was a dedicated container for whey after one has strained the cheese off. And this would mean that there was a chaîne opératoire already in the sixth millennium BCE that had to do with straining whey, with making cheese. And this requires, in a way, sour milk, yogurt maybe, and dried cheese, for instance, as you would call kurut, because you cannot make cheese without draining the whey off, because that's the definition of most cheeses, at least. So there is more than mere milk consumption already early on in the Neolithic. So that's a package, an item in the Neolithic. It fits nicely with the evidence that we have that there's no special, but what we don't see actually is specialized vessels. We have these vessels and everything was in them, from pulses to milk to meat, but there's no vessel that we could identify as a dedicated dairy vessel. And that is points a bit into the direction that milk use was something small scale, unspecialized, something that would just go along with the other products that you would get out of animals, but not a specialized thing. In the whole Neolithic, with the exception of perforated containers that maybe were sieves for straining cheese, we don't see any specialized dairy containers at all, with a possible exception of this suspendable vessel from Höyücek, which is, however, really, really small. So if that was used to churn butter out of a soured milk, for instance, it would have been really a tiny amount, but maybe we are only about tiny amounts of milk in these early days of the Neolithic. So dairy is widespread in the entire prehistory, but where dairy comes from the Near East, it is a warm climate, and where it later went to, into the temperate realms of Europe, there we have a cooler climate. And the funny thing that I find very interesting and debatable is that in cooler climates, spontaneous fermentation of dairy would not happen with the same fermentation germs and bacteria as it would in the warm Near East, where the Neolithic comes from. In the Near East, you would have thermophilic organisms that make yogurt, whereas in the north you have sour milk that only needs 20 degrees to ferment. And that's mainly Lactococcus lactis and other strains and bacteria. And these bacteria have one disadvantage for human metabolism. Mesophilic microbes don't provide a bioavailable lactase. So if you eat yogurt and you cannot digest lactose, then you probably don't have a problem, because that yogurt contains lactase from the Lactobacillus bulgaricus contained in it from the thermophilic lactic acid bacteria, and helps you to digest the lactose contained in yogurt. Whereas this is not the case in Northern European, Central European spontaneous milk products, where the lactase is not bioavailable to us. And that could have implications for interpreting why lactase persistence as a genetically determined trait has this peculiar pattern that we see. And this pattern is, we have no idea how old this pattern is and why it exactly emerged, but we have to think these microbes with it. And it's very interesting to see that this pattern cannot be older than the fourth millennium BCE, because in the graph on the right side, you see the first lactase persistent individuals emerging during that time period. And here we are back to our time period. A time period where we start to see specialized dairy vessels, or at least vessels that are highly suspicious of being specialized dairy vessels, because with the exception of that large vessel type from late Chalcolithic Anatolia that you see in the middle, there has not been a targeted program yet to sample vessels that are actually shouting out, I'm a suspendable churning vessel where one could shake sour milk and make butter out of it. And there are also vessel shapes in the Near East, for instance, shortly before and after the 3000 BCE, that could well have been used to pour butter oil out of them, or to actually clarify butter oil. And maybe we are talking about an increase of dairying, as Haskell Greenfield would put the secondary products revolution in the fourth millennium, an increase in the amount of milk that was available that had to be met with new dairying techniques, and of course, new crockery to process the milk. That is backed up by increasing pictorial evidence for dairy activities. And of course, now texts start. We are in the third millennium, late fourth millennium. We have first pictographs from the Sumerian area where this range of milk products is depicted. So there might really be something to this idea that biotechnology of milk dairying increases in the fourth millennium, maybe even with a manipulation and a targeted manipulation of the microbes involved going with it. So what did this do to the animals? Animals actually have a seasonality. They give birth in the late winter in the Near East, and then there is a lactation period. And then when spring starts and the green is sprouting, they are slowly weaned to the new grass and the new soft grass that they can now find in the nature. And this is why they are born in late winter. And normally a goat's reproductive cycle works like this, but man can change this cycle considerably if he just continues milking the goat or the sheep or the cow. Figures for days and lengths are a bit different with cows, of course, and sheep. But if you continue milking beyond the weaning age of the young, you can extend the lactation period by a considerable amount and thus reschedule your animal and, of course, get much more milk out of it. And this process might have even led to changes in the timing of the birth of young animals pretty early on in prehistory and again in the fourth millennium, as you shall see in a minute. I'm not going to lecture on how you can infer seasonality from oxygen, stable isotopes, from sheep and goat teeth, because I'm sure you've heard about this. But the results are here, and they are telling us that the first summer lambs, we are now talking sheep because no one has looked at goats yet that neatly, they also appear around our epoch-making period. So this fits nicely with the idea that lactation periods were manipulated in order to get longer lactation periods involving also later births, so you could even have milk in the winter, which is a fascinating idea and an intensification and also a speeding up and a breakless and seamless production of milk. But we don't know if that's true yet, but we see first indications that summer lambs survived into adulthood, although they were really difficult to raise into the winter. And this might also lead us to the idea whether during the fourth millennium, we don't only see time manipulation and maybe microbial biotechnology, but also something that would qualify as selective breeding. Neolithic husbandry likely was just a commensal selection that took place, like men wanted tame animals and preferred tame animals to mate with each other. And therefore these changes that you get during domestication occurred. But there is, I think, evidence that in the fourth millennium, people started to target really a breeding target, what they wanted, the phenotype of animal they wanted. And that's pretty closely connected to the research around the emergence of the woolly sheep, because if you as a sheep keep your under wool and your undercoat long and woolly, that's a very interesting genetic issue that's currently discussed in research. And we should not only look at the emergence of the woolly sheep, we should also look at other targets like the fat-tailed sheep. There's also genetic factors behind the emergence of that large fat deposit around the buttocks or at the tail. And that maybe was already a target in selection during the fourth millennium, but we cannot date the fat-tailed sheep at the moment, but we should look into it, I think. So that's to the future zooarchaeologists in the audience. The interesting thing about fat tail is a tail fat is that it's liquid at room temperature, very much like butter oil. Yeah? So you have a soft fat, not the tallow lard and the hard lard that you would get from carcass fat, for example. There's more hints at selective breeding because we see the first moles in the late fourth millennium. For example, at Tel El Umayr, which is early Bronze Age, shortly after 3000 BCE, but moles are really difficult to detect in the zooarchaeological record. And interestingly, as David Wengrow has pointed out to me during a discussion, that's exactly the time where we have in the Near East the first chimera-like mixed monster depictions. So as if people started to grapple with the idea if species can be mated and if we can get a monster or a mule out of it. So that's certainly was something that was on people's mind. And I hope I can explore this idea further. And you see in the subtitle of David Wengrow's book, the word, the age of mechanical reproduction. And that is taking us to the second big thing, to the engineering part of this talk. And cylinder seals are exactly something to illustrate what is meant here. The cylinder seals of the Near East are cylinders that you can roll and create a picture that is repeated as often as you want without any change. And they have a little hole where you possibly can put a stick through. So the whole thing is in a pivoted rotary motion. And that's what we are going to talk about now. Animal traction is attested in the Neolithic. That's out of questions. We have research from stature sites. That's a Southeastern European early Neolithic culture of the sixth millennium, where animals have been certainly used for pulling loads. We can imagine that they helped in timber logging for house construction, for instance, but we don't have any remains of the stuff that they were pulling. They were maybe even pulling threshing sledges. We have flint implements in the sixth millennium in Çatalhöyük West, where we are discussing whether they could be the inserts for threshing sledges as known in the ancient Near East. But that's still an open debate whether the threshing sledge predates the fourth millennium. And all what you can do with animals is, if you don't have a wagon, is that you have some rolling motion of a roller bearing, for instance, that you see at work here. Cow Emma, this is an experiment that we did several years ago together with Astrid Masson at the Domaine Dahlem in Berlin, will pull a 1-ton glacial erratic So a really heavy load comparable to what post-millennium people used for building their megalithic tombs with ease using such a roller bearing. So just a minute. And here she goes. And you see the disadvantage of the method. While you save a lot of effort in pulling, you don't have to pull yourself. You need a lot of people who shift rollers and make sure the whole thing remains in line and doesn't go off the track where you want it to go. So that's not really something we could call a reasonable and automatic process here. So you'd still need a lot of people. And there she goes, second time. So rotary motion is something that's very old. People have known about rotary motion early on. We have twisted fibers from Neanderthal times that you see on the left. And we have the staff and the spindle, at least in the Neolithic. But this turning motion that the spindle is doing and performing is just again another instance of complementary tool use, because the human is skillfully making sure that everything's going the way it should go. And the same is true of drilling. We know drilling holes from the Epipaleolithic, late Epipaleolithic of Southwestern Asia onwards, 10,000 BCE onwards, but these were drilled freely with the human steering the process. Such so-called drilling machines that you see in museum reconstructions have probably never existed. There's no evidence for them. Because the first instances of pivoted motion, which is not just rotary motion, but a constrained rotary motion that cannot go out of place, is attested only in the fourth millennium. You see a revolving door here, pretty bad photograph from an old publication of a megalithic tomb in France, and a wooden door from a lakeside settlement in Switzerland, which is actually the first, very first instance of pivoted motion that we have in human history. But the famous application is, of course, the wheel and the wagon. It's coming in two principles, as the rotating wheel and as the rotating axle, as Andrew Sherritt has pointed out. So you can choose whether you want the wheels to turn on the axle, which would be the rotating wheel, or whether the axle should rotate together with the wheels under the wagon. Such devices, such objects appear in a very sharp, tiny time frame within the end of the fourth millennium BCE over a large area of the ancient world. This is a map made by the Atlas der Innovationen out of the Topoi project that I have just mentioned. But if we look beyond the wagon, we see the principle also in other applications, such as the lever. Think about the shadouf, the water device in the ancient Near East, or also at the Pusta in Hungary, where with what you use for getting water out of a well or out of a canal. And we see them in the potter's wheel. We see them in the lathe, where you turn wood until it gets the desired shape. And that's a turned wooden piece from a tomb in the Levant, also from the third millennium. And we see it, of course, in the balance scale, of which you see two fragments, or a fragment on the lower left. So that's also a third millennium, late fourth millennium invention. And maybe we see it in the sail and the sailing ship, but I'm not sure. And the clue about this rotary motion that's pivoted, using something that you call the revolute joint. It's the first jointed connection that we know in human history at all. It's a fourth millennium thing, and it constrains the degrees of freedom that an object has in moving. by reducing it to one rotary axis. So the whole wheel cannot go left and right and not up and down. It can just turn around its own axis. And that was the start of a number of jointed connections, or as the kinematic people say, kinematic pairs in human history. The next one would be the prismatic joint, which was, I think, first applied in Hellenistic Greece with an early crossbow predecessor, and in the piston pump of the Romans. And then later, those other kinematic pairs come much later in the Renaissance and so on. So we can look at jointed connections from a pretty deep history perspective here. And it's exactly these joints that make the definition of a machine, if you don't use the European Union definition of a machine, because the European Union definition is as problematic as many things that are, and guidelines that are coming out of the European Union. Just think about the cucumbers that should not bend too much because of the EU guidelines. We should neglect the guideline of the European Union that says that a machine is only a machine if it's not driven by human or animal power, but we should use the international ISO standard, which says it does not matter what the power source is. What matters to make a thing a machine is the jointed connections of parts. And from your household understanding, you would all agree that the left thing, egg whisk, is a tool, whereas, although only driven by human power, the right thing is a machine, because it's connecting two egg whisks with a crank and so on. So that's certainly a nice example that we have, in fact, machines. And this, the wagon of the fourth millennium, would then even be an automotoric machine, because the human doesn't have to pull the thing by himself, but he can just steer the animals. But beyond the animal, the process cannot go wrong. So here the wheels cannot go where they want to. They don't behave like rollers in a roller bearing. They follow the wagon box wherever the wagon box shall go. So this is, in my opinion, one of the first machines. Whereas the bow and arrow, that is in some archaeological literature called a machine, is actually not yet a machine, because it's the human who is wielding the two parts together, as I said, also for a spindle, for example. So I would say that these complementary things could be something intermediate between a tool and a machine. So we could call it device. There's nice English vocabulary for this. But we should maybe think about extending Miriam Heidler's scheme into the Neolithic and even into the Copper Age, the fourth millennium, by adding more capacities. The quern and the mill. If rotary motion is the first thing to be invented in the fourth millennium, why on earth was the rotary principle not applied to grinding grain? Despite the existence of knowledge of the rotary principle, women had to continue doing the left device, the normal quern, for another 5 millennia or so, until in the first millennium BCE, the rotary mill that you use with your right hand only, if you're a right-handed person, was invented, or maybe not invented, but became widespread, and the principle became applied to the process of milling. And it is indeed, in ethnographic comparison, usually women who do this. And this finds nice corroboration in data on female upper arm load that has recently been published by a group around Pinhasi. And you see that in the Neolithic and in the Bronze Age and well into the Iron Age, the left arm is always the same strain on it. And in the Iron Age, the strain for the right arm even rises. And I can only, and the paper also argues like that, imagine that this is the onset of an entirely right arm use of the rotary quill. And then the drop in upper arm load you see in the succeeding medieval. This is the time when first mills that were driven by animals or by water were coming along in history. And that was a first real relief for women. And there's another but to this idea of mechanization in the fourth millennium. And that is, why is the art so late? The art is animal drawn, but we know that animal traction has been there before in the Neolithic for timber logging, for instance, because we have the skeletal evidence. And the art is not a machine because it doesn't contain movable parts that are jointed together in a revolute or whatever joint. So it's a bit of an oddity that the art is also only appearing in the fourth millennium. But nevertheless, the art is a crucial thing because it enables you to till so much more soil in the same time. It's a means of speeding up. It means that not your labor force is limiting your harvest, as Amy Bogart has recently elaborated the outcomes of the art in the old world, but the land is the limit, basically, if you have a team of oxen or cows and work your soil with them. So she sees in her paper a close connection between the degree of inequality and the mode of agriculture. So in art-based farming, she sees the increase of inequality quite a lot. And this is actually very reminiscent of reborn child's urban revolution ideas in a way. So we are coming back with new data to old ideas here. So to sum up, we are here to discuss whether these little highlights that I've shown you, which is only a little part of what happened in the fourth millennium, because we have to talk about linguistic shifts maybe, we have to talk about migrations maybe, although the huge migration wave was only later in the third millennium with the Yamnaya stuff that you have certainly heard about during the last 2 weeks. But these two highlights tell us that a lot was going on and a lot that is also intersectional in a way. So changes in one sphere, like animal breeding, would also influence the other sphere, like specialized draught oxen that were bred on purpose for their physical strength. So is that something where we could say there's a different mode starting, there's a different mentality and different approach to the world and to production in general visible in this? And for this, I think it could be helpful to say that the fourth millennium, or to put it more pointedly, 3000 BCE, could be a time axis or an epoch. If we put 3000 BCE into normal absolute and relative chronological tables, like the one that we have here by Jens Lüning, the classic chronology of the Central European Neolithic, 3000 BCE and the entire fourth millennium would be here, and it would cut through every kind of cultural divides that we see in the material record. So I'm not saying that we should abolish ceramic and other relative chronological units and entities, because we need them, because we can only date a site on a survey if we use the ceramic material, for instance, or the lithic material that we collect on that site. We cannot say we cannot collect evidence for a fourth millennium technical revolution by a survey. We need the material, we need the relative chronology, and we need this 14C chronology as well. But I think it would be good to add this time axis approach as a third dimension to our chronological thinking to overcome these pitfalls that we have, that, for instance, we call the funnel beaker culture, one of the first farming cultures in Scandinavia, Neolithic or even early Neolithic, although it is an art-based early Neolithic, which actually is impossible because an early Neolithic should not be art-based because the art is a fourth millennium, Copper Age, Bronze Age innovation. So it's the third dimension that we need here to get some idea of a global development and a global chronology apart from absolute chronology, because absolute chronology has pitfalls as well. Because if there's a delay, let's say if the art is earlier in Southwest Asia and it comes like a half a millennium later to Scandinavia, absolute chronology would tell us, no, this is not a time axis, whereas we could say, yeah, but maybe because of migration processes and cultural diffusion, it took longer, and we can still condense it into this axis, which is like the axial age of Karl Jaspers, not a moment in time, but a zone in time. And that's where we have to rethink our current use of chronological entity terminology, I think, because since enlightenment, we are using terms like age, era, phase, and period, and epoch quite synonymously. You find chronological systems saying that the Iron Age is an era, whereas others say, okay, no, the Metal Age is the era and the entire Paleolithic is an era, whereas the late Paleolithic is the epoch, others say it's a phase and so on. So there's not really a systematic approach to them, and we maybe don't need it, but we should be aware of the fact that until enlightenment, this I'm drawing on ideas published by Christopher Pear here, until enlightenment, history was seen as repeating itself. So all these terms like period and phase were actually meant as reiterating circles. So like processes that reiterate. And the epoch until enlightenment was a moment in time when you would go from one of these periods that reiterate into another one. It would be exactly the turning point that the very word epoche in ancient Greek does denote, the stop. Yeah? And the momentum, the moment, the turning point where things are reorganized. And my plaidoyer here would be that we restore part of that epoch word to use it for such turning points, and not for periods like the Bronze Age. It's not an epoch. Maybe the turn from the Bronze to the Iron Age, because the introduction of iron was a significant other time axis as well. That would be the epoch, the time between, maybe what you would call Dark Ages in some cases. Maybe that's the better application for epoch, and use ages and eras and phases for the other ones. And I also, and that's the final slide, I'm not sure if it's useful to put all the realms that we have been looking at into one linear pattern of consequent epochs or time axis, but make maybe time axis for different fields of human experience. For instance, it's easy with technology. We have talked about modular and composite and complementary tool use, and we have seen that maybe a kinematic use of material culture is the next step, and we can just guesstimate what's coming in the future. So I left this field blank here. So that's a pretty neat pattern and a pretty neat development and trajectory. But I would be hesitating to put the axial age idea right after that, as in some schemes that you have seen in my talk. But I would rather say that each human field of experience has its own trajectory. And for this, I would say for the realm of our interaction with animals, we should think about something like the natural selection. If we as hunters hunt animals, we take the weak out, we take the females out, we take the wonderful large antler bearing old stags out, for instance, thus exerting a certain kind of selection that's not a real natural selection anymore, like a wolf would do, but it's a human selection, but it's closer to nature. And then selection changes into something that biologists would call commensal selection during domestication. And only then comes the targeted selection that we've been talking about with the woolly sheep and races and applications of animals, maybe the fat-tailed sheep and so on. And then in the time that we are experiencing now, I see a new mode, which is the modifying mode, maybe with targeted genetic engineering by going into the very DNA without using reproductive cycles anymore. And the most difficult realm to grasp here is the symbolic and the realm of ideas, of thought, of attitudes. And I would put Miriam Heidle's notional capacity maybe into this lower yellow trajectory. And this notional capacity manifesting in art and symbolic culture gives way after a while, and again in the fourth millennium, to an informative capacity, to writing, where you can really say or actually transfer the spoken word into a document that is much harder to misunderstand than art, which needs always to be interpreted, whereas writing is a copy of spoken text onto written text. And maybe here we can put in the Axial Age ideas with values such as law, ethics, and equality, as the Seshat project has worked out. And we can only hope that in the next future, we are getting things straight with a new ethic for the new global challenges that we have. But I have no word for the ethics or for the mental leap and for the new Axial Age that we need to get the Anthropocene problem straight. Thank you very much for listening.